Good evening, all the participants. This is Pradeep Kumar. I am ex-chief general manager of ONGC. I was heading cementing R&D in IDT ONGC. Now I'll be giving you a brief about oil and gas well cementation. So I presume that all the participants are students. So I'll be covering only basic aspects of the cementing so that you can understand. So I will take about one hour plus in covering the topic, today's topic. And you can note down any questions there. In the end, we can have an interactive session for 10-15 minutes. You can raise the queries. So first of all, I'll start the presentation. First of all, actually, why we drill a well? Because till date, we do not have the technology to ensure the presence of hydrocarbon underneath. So we carry out the surveys first, geophysical surveys are just based on that. Actually, we release the location. And after reaching the location, we drill it. And unless we drill against the pay zone and we produce it, we do not have the, we are not sure whether hydrocarbon is present. So only by drilling, we know that hydrocarbon is present. And then to evaluate how the reservoir, then we need to drill further. We actually, well is drilled, it's a wildcat well or the exploratory well. Wildcat well is the one where we don't have any information about the field. That is the first well we drill. And the exploratory is one where actually we find out where the oil is and then we do delineation. Number of exploratory wells are drilled, then we ascertain how much hydrocarbon is present, then economic survey is done, and then we prepare a field development plan and further wells are drilled for development and we produce hydrocarbons. So drilling is necessary to know the presence of, to ascertain the presence of hydrocarbon. Now wells are drilled in telescopic manner. Why these wells are drilled in telescopic manner? Because hydrocarbons are generally found in sedimentary rocks and sedimentation has taken place over the years, millions of years, sedimentation of different types of rocks have taken place. So we have different types of rocks at different depths wherein the temperature, pressure and the conditions, chemical composition of the rocks is different. So you cannot go drill in a single hole. And if you drill a large hole, the weight of the casing of the equipment handled pipes will be so large that you cannot handle with the rigs capacity. These are the two reasons why we actually drill in the telescopic manner. And when you drill a well, the pressures, temperatures, and the chemical conditions, as I told, are different at different depths. So you need to cover the zones, drill it, cover with the casing, steel pipe, it is called casing, cement it, and then drill further. So you actually drill with a smaller bit. You cover the lower the casing, cement it, and then you drill a slimmer hole, drill further, and where you want to land, a casing design, casing seat is selected. Where the casing is lowered, then it is cemented. So rocks underlying the reservoir have different characteristics. As you see in the diagram I have shown, in the shallow water, the fresh waters are aquifers, we call aquifers are present. So those need to be isolated because in future you may have to produce the water from there. Portable purpose. Hello, am I audible? Hello.
Yes, sir. Audible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we lower. See, in the well schematics, I have shown different casing, surface conductor casing first, and then surface casing, intermediate casing, and the production casing is the last one. There may be one or more production casings. Okay, because the zones, maybe number of zone layers may be present in the formation which can be producing. So the bottommost object is produced first, whether it is oil or gas, then it is isolated. We come up slowly, slowly, one by one, and then from the top. And sometimes from the number of horizons, we take this thing by dual completion. We can take production from different objects in one go. So this schematic is there. Primary cementation is done. Okay. What is primary cementation? The casing cementation, the first one, the casing cementation is called primary cementation. All other jobs are secondary cementation. I will cover in my successive slides. Okay, each stage is secured and completed by lowering, I have already told, is lowering a suitable size of steel pipe. Now the casing pipes are held in a position by adequate length of cement. Why cementation is done? Because you want to hold the pipe in this in place, and you want to prevent the pipe from pushing. In the next slide, I will show you. Okay, cement is mixed in water and number of other additives, and the slurry is prepared, and using different high discharge and high pressure pumps are pumped down to pump the slurry downhole into the annulus. It is placed. I will show in subsequent how it is done. Okay, oil well cementing is the process of mixing a slurry of cement and water and displacing it down the casing tubing or drill pipe to a pre-specified point in the well. So in the casing, actually the bottom annulus is covered. Sometimes the cement rises up to the surface. It depends upon the requirement of the well, or sometimes we do not raise the cement up to the surface. Okay, some maybe column 500 meter, 600 meter. If any zone is prospective or any problematic zone is there, so we cover maybe 100, 200 meter above that top of the zone. And this first casing cementation is called primary cementation. All other jobs are called secondary. Subsequent jobs which to carry out are secondary cementation, which I'll cover subsequent slides. What is actually main function of cementation? It bond and support the casing. When I say bond, so you form when cement is placed in the annulus of the casing, it binds with the formation as well as with the casing pipe from outside. Okay, and then in between, when the cement is set, it will prevent any intrazonal migration of fluids. Because as I told you, the pore pressure of the different formations are maybe different, and different fluids are maybe present in the different formations. So the transfer of fluid from high pressure zone to the low pressure zone will take place. It is called interzonal type transfer of fluids. To prevent that, cementation is done. So both the zones are covered so that actually there is no migration of fluid from one zone to another zone. Another thing, you cover the cement so that actually there is no activity in the annulus up to the surface to prevent any flow of undesirable fluid to the surface that can lead to unnecessarily bottom hole increase in the bottom hole pressure, or if the hydrocarbons come up to the surface, accumulate at the surface and leakage takes place, it can lead to a catastrophe if it catches fire. So to control any undesirable flow of fluid, we actually carry out the cementation. So protect the casing from shock loads. Actually, when you do the cementation, primary cementation, then you are required to drill further hole in the streamer hole to drill deeper. So when you start drilling, there will be shock loads. You will be running with the bit, with the drill string, you will be applying weight on the drilling. There will be vibration of the string. So the shock loads also are transmitted to the casing to the this. So cement takes care of this actually. Shock loads also. Sealing of problematic zone, I've already told, and restricting of flow movement from the formation. Now, as I have shown in the first slide, there are different types of casing. The first is conductor, second is surface. Surface casing is lowered and cemented to cover the aquifers, future aquifers. So up to 1000 meter, there may be some aquifers present in this. So surface casing has to be lowered to cover that sweet water zones for future production of water, potable water. Then there may be a single intermediate casing or the number of intermediate casings. And at last, the production casing load, where we seek to take production from the well, either gas or oil. Then another type of cementation is called liner cementation. Liner cementation is the part of the casing only, but it is not run up to the surface. So liner is also only, it is run onto the drill pipe, and it is lowered and it is hung onto the previous casing. Casing hanger, liner hanger is used. It is called hanger. And the string is backed off from there, and the liner with hanger remains in the well, and the pipes running the liner actually are retrieved back. And it is cemented up to the hanger top. And it is sealed, it is tested. Both positive and negative testing is done after the cementation is done, and so that there is no migration of fluid. The advantage of running liner is lower cost. First of all, cost is reduced because liner is not run up to the surface. So we save on the cost of the liner, And another thing, wellhead. Wellhead is also not used because the previous wellhead is used and that will serve the purpose. And another advantage of using a liner is because suppose in the upper portion from the above the hanger top, you have the previous casing, the larger bore dia is available for the production. So you can take dual completion, you can do, or you can take production from a larger diameter tubing. So, and cementation, sometimes it is required to carry out in single stage. Single stage is the one when we mix the slurry and in one go, we carry out, displace the slurry, place the slurry, and that is called single stage cementation. And multiple stage, I'll demonstrate in the subsequent slide. Multi-stage is actually done in number of the times. So two stages is done. One cementation first stage is done, then circulation ports are opened. A special tool is used. I'll show you in the subsequent slide. Are you getting me? Hello?
Hello? Yes, sir. Yes,
yes sir. Sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, single-stage cementation. It is most common technique. It's mostly used early and first. When we do single stage cementation or the primary cementation, our objective is to do it right first time. Because when we carry out the repair jobs, it is very, very expensive. Very, very expensive. And the integrity is also, integrity of the well is also compromised. Because we for repairing the job, we need to perforate squeeze job that I'll show in the subsequent slides, how actually repairing is done. Okay. So the single stage, when we prepare the cement slurry, it is a properly designed. There are a number of aspects that I'll be covering in next 2 days. What all our aspects are there? What are characteristics of cement slurries are there? So we design the properly designed cement slurry and the volume that is actually pre-calculated based on the rise that is required behind the casing and the caving. Caving percentage is taken because when you drill a hole, it is not of perfect size. So there will be caving percentage. Then caliper log is also recorded. So based on the caliper log, we know the annular volume. So annular volume we know. So what height we need to raise the cement slurry. So we know the volume of the slurry. So we know the time, we know the pumping rate. Actually nowadays we carry out simulation jobs and then we know at what rate we are required to pump to achieve good cementation. So the rate is also known, volume is known. So we know how much time it will take. So the cement slurry is designed. There are a number of aspects to for designing of the slurries that I will cover later. So first is cement wall slurry is pumped. Now this is actually one slide which is demonstrating how casing is lowered. Casing is lowered. This is actually gray portion is cement. The previous, this is cemented, this casing. See now next casing is being lowered. It is run up to the previous casing shoe. Now it has gone down. Now the brown is actually mud. When you drill it, mud, and after that drill string is pulled out and the casing is lowered, running. So now the casing 958 is casing in the present case has run down to the bottom. Now we actually circulate the well thoroughly, bring down the parameters of mud to the lowest possible level, and so that well is coming, all the cuttings, cavings are removed so that the pressures are minimum. There is no breaching, there is no problem encountered during the cementation job. So well is conditioned, it's called well conditioning. So conditioning of mud is done, circulation as a required rate is done, and all the parameters, the pressure, everything is noted. So we know what pressures are expected when we will carry out the cement job. So because annular clearances and the inside clearance, that remains fixed. Okay, when you circulate it, condition the mud, and when you lower the yield point of the mud and the plastic viscosity of the mud parameters and lower the density of the circulation, lower the slightly the gel strength of the mud and density also to the lowest possible. It cannot be reduced further, maybe by 0.1 or so we can reduce this if the whole conditions permit. Please note down, if the whole conditions permit, then only this is carried out. And when all the properties of the mud are under as per the required values, then we start cementation. And cement slurry is pumped. This gray color cement is inside the casing, and it is now when the required volume is pumped, then it is displaced with the mud again. See the brown again up top portion, you are seeing brown. It displaced, slurry is being displaced and now it is being pumped into the annulus. It is rising into the annulus. Now this has risen. This has risen into the annulus, and the small quantity that you are seeing inside still cement is left. That is called shoe track. So shoe track, I will explain in the subsequent slide. What is shoe track and why it is required? So now displacement is complete, and now we allow the cement to set. Once the cement is set, then our job is complete. And if we have actually the now see the next now we will drill further, see with the slimmer hole. Now the drilling is complete. Now next casing, production casing is being loaded, 5.5 inch casing. So now it is at the shoe. We circulate. They do gel break or the small circulation is given at the shoe. Previous casing shoe. Now we runs. Okay. And now we have reached the bottom. The casing, next casing has reached the bottom. Now it will be circulated. Conditioning will be done. Now again the cement slurry will be pumped. Now it is being displaced. Now displacement is over. Displacement of production. Now production casing is over. So this is for your illustration. How it is done? Actually, you see the I have shown you the schematics. This actually the pink color top that equipment that you are seeing, it is called cementing head. It is a cementing head, okay, and it is a closed system. Why do we have this thing closed system? Because the slurry density is more than that of the mud. Slurry density is more. Generally, it is more than that of the mud. So what will happen? If you are actually pumping the adequate quantity of the cement slurry into the casing, there will be suction. So there has to be a closed system. Otherwise, if it is open, it will suck air, and you will have air entrapment of air in between the cement slurry. And then when it is displacement will be complete, it will be. So it has to be complete system, closed system, and this actually this cement. This cementing head, the arrow you see, this is cementing head, which is fitted on top of the casing. Now actually it contains plugs. These plugs you are seeing, this one is bottom plug and another is top plug. Actually these plugs are used to separate the mud with cement slurry. So inside you can separate the cement slurry with mud. Okay, because the same slurry is being displaced by the cement slurry, mud is being displaced by the cement slurry, then the cement slurry is displaced by the mud, so that it is actually displaced to the annulus. It is placed in the annulus. So this cement slurry, gray color, that this is cement slurry. So ahead of it is a bottom plug is used. When bottom plug goes down, and when it reaches this float collar, this equipment is called float collar. And this is float shoe. Float shoe and float collar are fitted about 2 joints apart. If the well is very deep, and if the condition permit, we actually separate it by 3 joints. Normally, it is separated by 2 joints. Why? Because there may be some thin layer of mud left inside the casing. When you wipe it, or at the end of the job, there is little bit contamination. So the contamination, because shoe is the most critical part of the casing. So the strongest should be the bottom, this shoe. This shoe should be the strongest. After cementation, this should have the maximum because you carry out the LOT value. So if actually shoe is not perfectly cemented, so it can lead to lower LOT value.
Excuse me, sir. Yes, sir, yes. I have one doubt. Yes. That is, now you have said that we are placed the shoe and then float collar. So there is a gap of one casing.
No, not necessary. See, it is always better. See, 2 joints apart. If you keep it, it is preferred to always keep it 2 joints apart. If suppose you have one, if it is you are lowering the production casing and you are not able to drill 10, 12, 13 meter extra, then sometimes replace it. It is better to have 2 joints. I told you if you are deep going very carrying out cementation of very deep casing. Is better to have even 3 joints apart.
Okay.
You sir, understand.
Sir, is there any specific reason behind that?
I'm telling you now. I'm telling you because see what happens. There may be some thin cake of this cement. against the wall of the casing. When it is white, it will get contaminated and it will get collected between the float collar and the shoe. And in the end, what happens, sometimes actually the cement slurry is not of proper this thing, mixture is not prepared. So there may be a little bit of contamination. So it is always better because you need to drill, maybe only few hours are wasted drilling one joint, cement. If you keep the cement of two joints apart, so you'll be required to drill the two joint cement. And if it is a production casing, we do not drill float collar. That is actually good for the integrity of the well entire, because the well is going to produce for years, maybe 20, 30, 40 years. Are you getting me?
Yes, sir.
So it is always better to have two, or if the well conditions permit you for deep casings, you keep float collar and float shoe three joints apart. There is no harm. Only small quantity of cement is wasted and then one joint is wasted. But for the integrity of the well, it is always better, because these are positives. This top plug acts as a positive barrier.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay.
So now, okay, sir. Okay.
Now we will take questions in the end, because I have to cover. I am also speaking quite fast because I need to cover a lot of this thing topics.
Okay, sir. Okay.
So
thank you, sir.
Shall I move on?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sure. Okay.
Now you can see, after circulation is over, now it is, I have not depicted here, it's actually spacer or the pre-flush is also pumped, because inside the casing you have a barrier, rubber plug is used for separating the contamination of a cement slurry with the mud, and again when you're displacing it, this mud with the cement slurry, this a top plug is a barrier and the bottom plug is the barrier for this. Okay, got it. But in the endless, we don't have any barrier. So what is the barrier actually that prevents mixing of cement slurry with the mud? Because mud may contain many chemicals which may not be compatible with cement slurry. That will affect if it get contaminated. So we use spacer or the pre-flushes which are actually compatible with both cement slurry as well as mud. Okay. And for water-based mud, we use normal. Maybe if my experience says, if the well permits, the water is the best cleaning agent, best spacer. But if the well does not permit, then you have to use weighted spacer. Okay, if the slurry weights are more, if you have a gas well and the pressures are high. So in no case, I will explain in the subsequent slides. Okay, this process you have understood, everybody has understood how the cement is, top plug is a solid plug. And see the color is different to differentiate between the two. Because accidentally, if you lower the top plug first, the strength of the top plug is more than that of the casing. Okay. This will not bust. When you bump the plug, the entire slurry will remain inside the casing. If you accidentally drop the top plug before the first, accidentally fill off. So that is why the color, different color is used. And physically also, one should see, the operator must see, because there is a diaphragm here, this diaphragm, the arrow, you can see the diaphragm is here, it is a thin rubber. So before this thing, lowering it, one, the operator must check it by pressing it, sometimes because of, it is excessively vulcanized, because this has a core at the center. I will show this separately. If it is at the center of this aluminium core is there, and on top is vulcanized. Suppose there is a very thick layer of vulcanized rubber, even if it is bottom plug, but it will not rupture. So the operator must check it, that diaphragm is pressing with the thumb. As soon as this actually, this bottom plug rests on the float collar and you keep pumping, the pressure against this diaphragm is applied, and it gets rupture, and the cement slurry passes through this and through the shoe. And it starts rising into the endless until this top plug reaches and rests on this here. When the displacement is complete, this top plug rests on this, and this is a solid. This is solid, solid core. So pressure will shoot up. So it means your displacement is complete. The slurry is between the float collar and the float shoe. and it has risen into the annulus to the desired height. Here in my case, this in the picture shown, we have raised the cement up to the surface. Okay. But in all the cases, it is not necessary. It depends on the well and the requirement, well requirement, well design, where we need whether to raise the cement up to the surface or we raise the cement only to cover any problematic zone or any zone, okay, any zone which may actually becomes active. So we cover that zone only, maybe 150, 100, 200 meter above that zone. Not necessarily we raise the cement up to the, because see, it has advantages and disadvantages as well. Because if you raise the cement up to the surface, some actually experts, they say it should be covered up to the surface. Okay, it gives additional protection to the casing as far as corrosion is concerned. But suppose the well becomes active in future because of microinlets created. Gas can pass through the microinlets, but water or other fluids cannot. Because what happens over the life of the well, casing is pressurized, depressurized because of so many activities and contraction expansion of the casing place, microinlets is created behind this thing. So through which the gas can percolate and it can get up to the surface, giving pressure at the wellhead. So that is undesirable condition. But if you have actually covered the cement up to the surface, then it is difficult to carry out the repair job, lubrication. Are you acquainted with the word lubrication? Then if you do not have the cement up to the surface, suppose in between the mud will be above that cement and we can lubricate heavy mud, we can pump and allow it to settle. That will take care of the bottom hole pressure. Okay. So sometimes actually we do not raise the cement up to the surface. But it depends on the requirement of the well. Okay. But if you are carrying out some hydrofracturing jobs, then you apply very high pressures. In that case, to take, because tensile load, I'll cover in my subsequent class, maybe tomorrow, day after tomorrow, I'll tell you how it actually, the stresses act on the cement slurry. That time, actually, we require the cement rise up to the surface. Now, this is actually for the same thing. Now, inside the casing, nothing, no implements are used, but outside, we use centralizers, turbolizers. All these actually accessories are used to keep the casing centralized. If the casing is not centralized, the fluid during displacement will take the least path of resistance. Where the gap is more, the fluid will flow through this and the mud will not be removed from where the distance is less. Okay, this we call it standoff. I will cover I'll tell you what standoff is, how we actually design the slurries. So this is actually centralizers is used to centralize the casing outside. Sometimes scratchers or other implement sets are also used outside the casing on the outside. And ECP external casing cracker is also used. And this is actually float collar and the float shoe. These are the plugs. This is guide shoe because there is no NRV. So this is guide, actually it guides this because you see the bottom is round. It is made of cement and this is steel casing, part of the casing, and it is reinforced inside. And this guide shoe actually guides the casing to go to the bottom. It will have, suppose it has sharp edges, it will get obstruct the casing and difficulty will be faced in lowering the casing. So this, if it has NRV here, like here, you have NRV. Why NRV is required? Hello? This NRV is required because, as I told you, the cement slurry density, I'll go back, cement slurry density in the annulus, it is more than this density, mud density. So there will be a back pressure here when the cement is in liquid stage. So if you do not have NRV, you can still prevent this fluid, cement slurry, flowing back into the casing by closing the wall. But in what will happen? You will be required to keep this closed as long as this slurry is in liquid stage. So what will happen? Because there is temperature at the bottom is higher if you keep this wall closed, then what will happen? Because of the pressure, the casing will expand and the bond will be poor. When you actually release the pressure, that is why these actually devices are used. This is float collar and float shoe are used. These are NRVs to prevent this float collar is actually one is additional wall. One is this wall, this is float shoe, and there is another additional check wall is there to prevent flow of cement slurry back into the endless, because this slurry being heavier, it will flow back into the endless. To prevent that, it is there, and float collar also acts as a resting device for plugs to know that the displacement is complete. Actually, plugs also rest on the float collar. Okay, it's called float because it has NRVs. Both this has NRV. If it does not have NRV, it is then guide shoe only, simple guide shoe. These are centralizers. This is solid blade centralizer. This is actually, and these are made of high carbon steel, spring steel. Spring steel, these are made bows. Now, once actually cement is set, the migration of fluid can take place. If it is not properly cemented from within the cement inside the well, from here, you see red arrows are showing this thing migration from the gap between the casing and the cement. Okay. And from within the cement, as I have actually seen elaborated within this arrow, you can see the migration can take place. Or there, suppose there are channels in between the cement. There are channels in between the cement, the migration of fluid can take place. So this is actually undesirable condition. We want for perfect cementation, there should not be any migration of the any formation fluid into the cement slurry or after the cement is set. There should not be any channels left behind. For that, what is the requirement? For successful cementation, all mud, including filter cake, along well bore should be removed and replaced by uncontaminated cement. Cement should not get contaminated. Otherwise, once it is contaminated with cement or any other material, with the thing, whatever present in the cuttings are present, it get mixed in the cement slurry, it will not have the ultimate strength for which actually the cement is designed. So, and their channels may be formed, or if the filter cake is not removed, as I showed in the previous, filter cakes are not removed. Filter cake between the formation and this thing well bore, there are actually thin mud cake is there, mud cake that has to be removed. So how it is removed? So we use different additives in spare. I told you, the pre-flushes are used, washes here, because inside we use rubber plugs that wipes the casing and keep the cement slurry and this mud separated. But where is an endless, you need to do some activities to remove the cake completely, and there should not be any contamination. So for that, we actually have flow regimes. The best way to replace the mud completely, if you remove the mud and mud cake completely with the cement slurry, the cement jog is going to be perfect, provided there is no loss or no activity. I'll actually explain in the subsequent slide. So to achieve above an uncontaminated cement, pre-flush or properly designed spaces to be used inside casing, rubber plugs that I have already mentioned. So for good displacement efficiency, ideally all parameters. Now what we are doing? After circulation, we are pumping cement slurry. Now the cement slurry will be displaced by the mud. So the displacing, ideally, what should be the property for the proper displacement? All the parameters, namely density, that is specific gravity, viscosities, both yield point and the plastic viscosity, and the gels of the displacing fluid should be more than those of displaced fluid. This is a prerequisite. Okay. So we need to maintain the hierarchy that I will cover tomorrow, because this is a preliminary class. I will cover tomorrow in detail. So how actually we maintain density hierarchy and rheological hierarchy, we call, okay, to achieve good cement mud displacement by cement slurry. And then we actually displace as far as possible to remove the mud completely. We need to displace the cement slurry in turbulence. Turbulence, you know, there are actually laminar flow. Perhaps you might have studied in your mud class
in
fluid mechanics, drilling fluid mechanics. So, wow, what is turbulence? What is laminar flow? So, in turbulence, actually, you need the Reynolds number is actually your critical. We should exceed the critical velocity. Okay, which is determined by this thing, and when actually it is calculated, and we have simulators also. So, what displacement rate is required to achieve that critical velocity? That depends on the cement slurry design, mud parameters. Okay, cement slurry. Actually, we know what is the critical velocity for a particular this hole size, and so for that we add actually a friction reducer also in the cement slurry to achieve the critical velocity at a lower discharge rate. Okay, so when it actually the Reynolds number is more than this velocity is more than 2800 or some people say 3000, then it is actually critical velocity. This is actually turbulence. Well, is in turbulence. Okay, so if you displace, but in turbulence you need to displace at a very high rate, very high discharge rate. But sometimes, well, there may be thief zones. Thief zones means there may be weak zones. Because when you are pumping at a very high rate, then what happens? The pressure also goes up, pumping pressure. So the ECD goes up. So when ECD goes up, there are chances that from the thief zone, the loss may occur. So you will not have the rise of cement. The cement slurry will go or the mud will go inside. And it may be lead to a catastrophic condition. Suppose there is a pay zone and you have excessive loss, you are not able to control, you are not able to fill the well. It may lead to some catastrophe also. Okay, so that is undesirable. So in all times, read point number 3, hydrostatic head exerted by all fluids against the formation all the time, including ECD, should be more than that of the formation pressure. It should always be more than this. However, it should never exceed the fracture gradient to prevent cement slurry or the mud loss. You got it? This is a very, very, very important point in while designing the cement. So all these 3 points are very important. You should note down. Now, major consideration for cement design. So when you design the cement slurry, one is thickening time that I'll cover in detail when I'll tell you the cement slurries. Thickening time is the time when you mix it. We make the dry cement mixed with the water with some additives. Okay, then it is mixed, a slurry is formed. When a slurry is formed, it has initial consistency. Consistency is nothing but you can call it viscosity. Okay, but the consistency, the viscosity of the cement, it is called consistency because it changes with time. Otherwise, you can consider it as a viscosity only. Okay, when you actually have a certain viscosity, if the viscosity is very high, it cannot be sucked.
Sir, you're saying Bearden consistency?
Bearden unit of consistency is called Bearden unit of consistency, BC. It is called BC. Okay. Indirectly, because I am in layman's term, I am telling you it's similar to viscosity. Okay. Like you have honey, which has more viscous than water. Or the thinnest, you have alcohol, which is the thinnest. Okay. The yield point is minimum. So the thickening, see, initial consistency, why it is important? Because that slurry that will be mixed at the surface, but it has to be sucked. Once it is actually pumped out of the pump, reciprocating pumps are used for pumping the slurry, which I'll demonstrate later. See, these pumps are actually pumping the slurry. Once actually the slurry is in the well, then it has to be displaced. Okay. For sucking the slurry, the maximum consistency, the API says it should be 30 BC. Whereas in ONGC standard, I am from ONGC, we say it should be maximum 25 BC. We do not accept. Lower the BC means thinner the slurry, it is easier to suck the slurry. Okay. So it should not be more than 30. If it is beyond 30, you will not be able to suck it. Even if you use superchargers or recirculating pumps, but it has to be sucked from some this thing, some place. Okay, you need to have a net positive suction head to suck that slurry. So if it is more than 30 bc, you will not be able to suck it. But for displacement, thickening time, when once it achieves 100 bc, and some companies say 70 bc. Okay, but in ONGC we consider 100 bc. Beyond 70 bc also you will not be able to displace it. But there is hardly any time gap between 70 bc and this thing, because that is transition time that I will explain later what is transition time. So thickening time should be is the total time when you can carry out the operation, when you can displace it. Once operation means complete operation is when you bump the plug, that is bumping the plug, or you are carrying out squeeze job, you means you are finished with the squeeze, final squeeze pressure, that is the thickening time. Okay, so time when you attain the bc from initial bc to 100 bc, that time is called thickening time. So the thickening time of the slurry is designed so based on the bottom hole temperature conditions. Okay, but temperature, because as the temperature goes up, the thickening time goes on reducing, and pressure also have, but it has little effect on the thickening time. There are some other parameters also. Okay, so thickening time is the time, total time plus safety time, total times to be taken by the job to complete. You know the volume, you know the mixing rate, you know the displacement rate, you know how much total time it will take, plus you take some safety margin. So that should be that your thickening time should be more than, slightly more than, with some safety margin, more than that total time taken by the job. And as soon as the displacement is complete, the your design should be such, it should not be remain, the slurry should not remain in the liquid form in for very long period of time, because when the cement starts setting, it loses its hydrostatic head. At that time the formation fluids enter into the thing, if actually the hydrostatic head, net hydrostatic head reduces, the formation fluids will enter into the cement slurry, which is not set, completely set, but it has thickened, but it is not set. So there will be channels will be created and your job will be spoiled. So the once you complete this thing, then consistency should low, and suddenly the consistency should pick up. That is called right angle slurry. I will show tomorrow, because that part in detail I will cover that in tomorrow lecture. So during setting time of cement loser, I have already told this. Now, as I told you, this in the endless we need to complete the displace the mud completely, and there should not be any contamination. But there will be some contamination, because you whichever best mechanical aids you use, whatever best programs you use, you reciprocate the casing, rotate the casing, you use the centralization. But 100% centralization is also not possible, because nowadays you highly inclined wells, maybe horizontal wells also. So 100% is not possible to achieve. Okay. So if you is required, so the calculation is done, and the simulators starting place of force, as you rotate the case, you can rotate the case while circulating in cementation. So and you get the mud removed. We are older wells. We are using buttress sets and the conventional centralizers we use. So those actually start rotating, all the centralizers break, and that way may create some additional problem. So these are the sketches. You are seeing this. These sketches. These are sketches, mud sketches. So these are rarely used these days. Now see, it is rotating, showing arrow. Okay, this arrow is actually shown in the wrong direction. I'm sorry. I have taken the picture. Why it is shown? Because it is showing in left hand direction, anti clockwise. If you rotate the thing in anti clockwise direction, you may land in a problem. You may open the string, so it should be other way round. Got it? So now here you see, if the casing is not centralized, to see the white, this thing, it white, you may say it is cement slurry. Cement slurry will take the least path of resistance and the portion where actually it is spacing is near the wall or the touching the wall, it will not cover. So our purpose will be defeated, and you can see the formations here. The fluid may pass through here, though the cement is good here. And when you record, to evaluate the cement bond, CBL VDL is recorded. It shows the average heating. For that, you need to record advanced logs, UCIT, etc. Then only you can know the channels. Okay, this, see the formations are there. So there will be interzonal migration. Okay, so you lose the production. Or not only production, or there may be some, if the gas or oil starts coming up to the surface, migrates to the surface, it can lead to some more this thing, safety issues. So this is a liner. As I told you, the liner is not lowered up to the surface. You see this is casing. So, and this is the liner. This is liner hanger, the green, small green you are seeing. It is the hanger. It is only a schematic diagram. Okay. So this is the casing. The advantage of using the liner is actually this overlap. This is called overlap period. This is overlap. Because if you lower the line, hanger top, you keep here. So this, again, the integrity will be of the well will be affected. Suppose the bond is between this overlap is not good. So we need to keep a sufficient overlap, maybe 50 to 150 meter, highly inclined wells, we keep maybe up to 150 to 200 meters also, provided there is no specific zone here, because we try to avoid this thing, double casing perforation. Suppose zone is there near the shoe, then we actually optimize this. Okay. So this also has a, this liner has a packer. It is a separate cementation. Someday when I'll cover liner cementation exclusively, then I'll cover, I'll show you in detail what the liner components, what is this. So now this liner is up to here. So you save the casing cost, liner casing cost up to the surface here. So such a long, this thing, column you saving. And the another advantage is for any producing layers here, you have a larger, bigger diameter. You have bigger diameter here. So you can use bigger completion tools, bigger this thing. That is another advantage of having the liner. And wellhead is also not required, because this wellhead, 9.58 inch, this wellhead will only be used. So we save on this cost of the wellhead, casing, and it is this. So this is actually conventional liner. There are different types of liner. Some expandable liners nowadays also used, which I will not go into detail. Now this is a liner cement, conventional liner cementation job. Now this is a two-stage cementation. So we have, so far we have covered single-stage cementation. When we prepare one lot, cement slurry in one lot, and we actually pump it down the hole, and displacement is complete, and the job is over. But sometimes there may be the requirement of hole conditions that you cannot have. Suppose your producing zones are quite far, maybe 1,000 meter away, maybe 1,500 meter away. If you cover the cement with a single stage, the first of all, cement slurry, which is actually when reaching up to the top, will get contaminated. And the hydrostatic head exerted by the such a long column may lead to loss in the thief zone, in the weaker zone, against the weaker zone. So we may not like to cover this in cement slurry in such a, in single stage, and it may take very long time. Okay. So for that, what we do, we use a special tool called stage collar. Stage collar, this is a stage collar that we use. We actually place it appropriately above the top of the first stage cementation. Suppose we decide the first stage cementation up to here, then the stage collar is fitted here. So that now from here onwards, we carry out the cement job in two stages. We do. We carry out the first stage cementation. Then once it is over, then we open the ports here. I will show you on the next slide. This is actually bomb trip plug. You open the ports and you carry out the second stage cementation. So you cement this portion above the stage collar, and this portion separately. So the cementation is done in two stages. After first stage, we keep circulating unless this first stage cementation thinning time is achieved. Otherwise, what will happen if it is actually, if you carry out this thing, second stage cementation early, then the first stage cement slurry is still in liquid stage and there is not much advantage that actually was intended. This second stage cementation, long, I have already said long hole diameter, where actually we cannot, first stage cementation cannot be carried out, the column is too long, or some thief zones are there, then also limitation of cementing equipment is also there, you cannot pump such a large volume, then also we may go for two stage cementation. So this is actually, see, the exploded view of multi-stage cementation, two-stage cementation stage collar. So it has ports. You see the holes here, white color holes. These are the ports. And it has actually two sleeves. One is actually opening sleeve, another is closing sleeve. You see in orange color, this is opening sleeve, and this is actually trip plug. This is called, also called opening plug or the trip plug. It is filled with the lead. It is heavy because if the mud weight is high, then it will take long time to travel, or it may not even, in inclined wells, it may not reach up to this opening sleeve. This may not reach in high angle wells. So what we do nowadays, actually, in very high angle wells, more than 40, 50 degree wells, we are using hydraulic stage collar, hydraulic tool. When you apply pressure, one certain pressure apply exceed the pressure, then this automatically, because of pressure, this sleeve opens. You need not use the mechanical device for opening the sleeve. Okay, but this is conventional sleeve. This when it goes and rests on the sleeve after the first stage is over, then we drop this strip plug. And when it goes and rests against this yellow orange color, this sleeve, and we apply the pressure. The pressure forces the sleeve down. There are shear pins here, PTD shear pins. The shear pin actually shears, and this sleeve slides down, rendering the inside to open to the open ports. Now you can establish circulation through this. There's actually fluid can circulate. Now you can circulate condition, can you see the ports? These ports are aligned with these ports, outside sleeve. The inside, this opening sleeve, the pore holes are aligned with these holes. Once actually this slides down, and you can establish circulation behind the casing through this. But since it is a second stage cementation, there are limitations also in second stage. What are the limitations? You cannot reciprocate or rotate the casing because some first stage cementation is already done. Okay. And you are carrying out the second stage cementation after the thickening time of the first stage cementation. Then you are not supposed to disturb that. Only you are circulating at the stage collar. So you should not disturb this. So you cannot reciprocate or rotate. That this is the limitation. So you should fix number of centralizers in this, because you cannot reciprocate or rotate the casing in the second stage of cementation. Got it? And this is the bypass. This, you see, this core is small. This passes through this. This is called, also called bypass plug. This is a first stage plug. And when it actually passes through this, and it rests on the baffle plate, which is fitted on top of the landing collar or the float collar. Okay. And this trip plug, I have already explained, this is actually for opening this, mechanical opening. And if it is actually hydraulic stage collar, you apply the pressure and open, then you may not use this, but it is provided by the manufacturer, because if the sleeve does not open with the application of pressure, then you have to lower this. Sometimes what happens, because of the limitation, because against this, suppose this against the ports, the formations are weak. Then if you are not using this, you apply more pressure. And when suddenly the ports are open, the excessive pressure applies against the formation and the loss may occur. So in those conditions also, we use the trip plug unless the angle is very, very high. If the angle is very high, it will not reach at the bottom. If the suppose angle is of the order of against the stage collar or in between is maybe 70 degrees, 75 degrees, it will not go down. You will be required to push it down using drill collar, and which is very difficult. You need to have false rotary, push it down, it will take long time. Okay, now it is clear. Now, next. What are the thing? Post-job consideration, design consideration. Once actually cement is placed, I have already told you what is thickening time and how it is actually calculated thickening time. So based on your job, this total time with subsafety time, it is actually thickening time is calculated, design, slurry, this okay. So, but our post-job, what are the things? When cement is placed, we have to allow the cement to set. Now when the cement becomes hard, how hard it should become to carry out further operations. So suppose it is an intermediate casing or the surface casing, then we need to drill it, okay? Because we have plugs, two plugs, top plug, bottom plug, and in the shoe track also we have cement. As shown in the second slide, the shoe track, the cement is there. So that cement has to be drilled out, and we have to drill the shoe, then circulate and take record LOT or PIT, whatever is the case. So waiting on cement is required. For drilling, for resuming drilling, 500 PSI, it is a general convention that 500 PSI strength or compressive strength is required for cement to resume drilling. And for perforation, it is 2000 PSI. Okay. But see, nowadays actually wells, depleted wells are there, shallow wells where are there. So there actually we use special cement slurry that I'll explain tomorrow, day after tomorrow, where actually we may not even require 2000 PSI also. Very lightweight slurries are used. So this is a general convention. So there's actually cement slurry design, and we calculate the strength also. So we know in the laboratory, we calculate after at bottom hole static temperature, because compressive strength, thickening time, remember, thickening time is calculated on based on bottom hole circulating temperature. When you start circulating, because cement job is done at the circulation, when circulation is going on. So we have to consider for thickening time, circulating bottom hole circulating temperature, which is lower than the bottom hole static temperature. Okay. But once the cement slurry is placed, the heat transfer takes place and the slurry attains the static temperature after a few hours. So the cement strength is seen at the static temperature. Okay. Bottom hole static temperature. These are two temperatures, BHCT, BHST. Okay. So to know how to control the thickening time, setting time, all this, and properties, as I told you, that cement has to be displaced in turbulence. So we have different cement additives. Okay, for accelerator means it will shorten the thickening time, accelerate. It will accelerate the setting of the cement. So thickening time will be reduced. So we use accelerators where it is required most in actually when we are drilling in deep water with the floaters, where the cost of the rig is very, very high. So there we are, and gas hydrates are present in deep water. So there we need to shorten this, and the temperature is very low. Maybe bottom hole temperature is only 4 or 5 degrees centigrade. So there the cement will not set. So for that temperature, we need to add accelerators. And sometimes we are required to have, when you are drilling a deep well, carrying out cementation of deep casing, or you are carrying out sweep job, secondary job you are carrying out. So you need a longer thickening time. Or suppose you are using expandable liner, where you may have to require a thickening time of 15 hours because you need to expand the liner, okay, after placing the cement slurry. So if it is set, you will not be able to expand the liner, and cement is set, then your all the process is spoiled, well is spoiled. And this you see third property, this is fluid loss additive. This is very, very vital. In drilling fluid also, fluid loss control is required. Okay, that in detail I'll explain tomorrow. What is fluid loss additive? When you add these additives, the fluid loss, what happens actually, this cement slurry comprises of what? Solids in it, that is cement and water and some additives. Because it contains water, and for hydration of cement, only 28% water is required, whereas the remaining 16% remains in the matrix. But why you add normally 44% water is added in class G cement? In India, we use class G cement, and somewhere else in worldwide, class H is also generally used. Actually, there are different classes, but in India, because we manufacture class G only, and it is actually used for a wide range of the same temperature, pressure, and all the ranges actually it can be used. Only particle size and small difference is there. The density of H is slightly less. Particle size, I will cover tomorrow what is the importance of particle size distribution. So in class G, generally in India, we use class G, and worldwide also, mostly class G is used. Some countries use class H also in oil well cementation. So fluid loss, what is fluid loss? So fluid loss is actually because water is present in it, when pressure is applied, so against permeable zones are permeable. Permeable means actually fluid can pass through. Okay, that is permeable. Because of permeability, only oil and water flows from the formation into the wellbore when you take production. Similarly, other side, if the excessive pressure is applied onto the cement slurry, and then slurry, the water will go enter into the formation, and the cement slurry will be starved of water. It will become thin, and it can form bridging. That is called bridging. Suppose it loses excess water from the cement slurry, it will become thick gel. You will not be able to displace. So your purpose is defeated. From the place where we want to displace the cement, in between the excess water will be lost. So we need to control the fluid loss. Okay. And water separation, other properties are, but these are main this thing additives. Anti-settling, there are so many other properties also there. As I've already told, in class G cement, 44% water is used for 15.8 ppg. In ppg, and when you use 44% water by weight of cement, always actually when we calculate all the additives that we add to the cement, except salt. Salt is added by weight of water, whereas all other additives are added by weight of cement. So 44% water is added to the cement. Suppose one sack of cement, that I'll explain calculation tomorrow when I'll tell you tomorrow or day after tomorrow, what calculation, then I'll tell what is the weight and all that, everything. So free water content, this is a requirement, it should be maximum 1.4%. So compressive strength API, this is actually API 10, normally 10 series is there, 10 Ds for centralizers, 10 Bs for cement slurry design, 10 A's for cements. So, okay, 10 series actually are for cement API. API is their American Petroleum Institute. You can read and refer this actually, some of this. So, this says after 8 hours at 38 degree centigrade, 300 PSI should be the minimum. This is when we purchase the cement, these are the specifications that we put. These are the requirements along with some other important specifications that I'll tell you, class G. These are basic. So, accelerators, I've already told, water retarders. So, commonly used accelerators are sodium chloride, calcium chloride. Normally all chlorides are accelerators. Okay. So these actually retarders. So these retarders are lignosulfonates and carbamoxyl, ethyl hexanols, or many acids, aromatic acids are retarders. And there are many specific retarders of the companies which manufacture. All these major companies, Halliburton, Baker, and Schlumberger, they manufacture their own this thing additives, and they have characteristics that some of which I'll cover tomorrow, day after tomorrow. So dispersants and the friction reducers. So dispersants actually are same thing as friction reducers and dispersants. One is the same thing actually, but if you put excessive friction reducers in the cement slurry, what will have? It will have a settling tendency. So in high angle wells, you should not. So everything, all the additives have to be designed properly and adequate quantity has to be added as per the design values. If you add, suppose, what happens if you add more of a fluid loss additive? And most fluid loss additives, are retarders also. So if you put excess of fluid loss additive, you are controlling fluid loss. But with the addition of fluid loss, you are retarding the cement slurry. Okay. Some very expensive, some fluid loss additives nowadays are available, which are non-retarding in nature. When actually for special jobs we use it. If I have enough time, I'll explain what are those additives or what is the purpose. So these are lightweight. So slurry, as I told you, because sometimes actually mud weights are very less. And if you are using conventional slurry, whose actually specific gravity is 15.8 ppg, and 15.8 ppg, the formation may not sustain. And if your mud weight is low, and you do not require that much of high this thing because your formation cannot sustain. So what actually we do, the difference between the specific gravity should be of, ideally should be 2 ppg. If the well conditions do not permit, we sometimes actually have a difference in slurry densities in 1 ppg also. So, but ideally it should be 2 ppg, minimum 2 ppg difference should be there between weight, cement, mud weight and the cement density and the spacer. The spacer should have denser by 2 ppg than mud, and the cement slurry should be still denser than spacer by another 2 ppg. So the density is actually density hierarchy. It is called density hierarchy. Density hierarchy is maintained. So the according to the well conditions, sometimes we use lightweight slurries. We can have lighter than even water cement slurries. If you have used nitrogen, so you can have a cement slurry of 7.5 ppg also. Nitrogen foam is used as a nitrogen, and it should have adequate strength. It is designed, and it has in the laboratory it is designed, it's simulated, and it has sufficient strength. So sometimes when well conditions do not permit, we use very lightweight slurry, and normal this metakaolin, spanded perlite, mentonite, micro this thing nowadays. Spherical balls are also used. We call microspheres. Microspheres are used, and those microspheres are also different compressive strength. Come, okay. 3M also manufactures, and many other companies nowadays manufacture. So heavyweight additives are also added, like hematite ore, ilmenite, which are iron ores, barite, micromax. Micromax is trimanganese tetroxide. Okay. This is quite heaviest, and it has the advantage of using micromax. It has a very good rheological properties. Hematite, ilmenite nowadays actually rarely used, because these actually adversely affect the rheological properties of the cement slurry. So nowadays micromax is used, tetramanganese oxide. It's a oxide of manganese. Now secondary cementation. All these I've explained first two-stage cementation, liner cementation, and your first stage cementation, two-stage. So these are all primary stage cementation. These are carried out after lowering the casing. But secondary cementation is there. What is secondary cementation? All other jobs other than primary cementation jobs, first cementation job, these are called secondary cementation. One is plug cementing. Plug cementing is what? Placing the cement plug at a designated depth in designated length of column. Okay. Length of column is placed at a designated depth. That is called plug cementing. And when you apply the pressure and against the perforations or in the leak casing, you apply the pressure in the slurry form so that the cement slurry goes into this and repair the casing or repair the bad cementation. So that time also squeeze job is carried. That is squeeze job when you apply the pressure. Low pressure squeeze job, high pressure squeeze job. I'll explain. So, okay. Now, cement plug can be set at different distance. Suppose excessive loss is taking place with a conventional mud pills, loss circulating pills. You are not able to stop the circulation. Then as an ultimate or the last resort, we place the cement plugs to control the losses. Or suppose some fish is left, you need to deviate. So above the fish, you place a cement plug and deviate the wells. Sidetracking is done. That is called sidetrack plug. Okay. And suppose depleted zones are there, now the loss will take place. So we have to place the plug and sidetrack, or any problematic zone comes and then we have to plug. And one is abandonment. Once the life of the well, suppose you do not strike any oil or gas, you are not producing it. So now that well has to be abandoned. So at different depths, we place that abandonment plug. Okay, at the surface, at the intermediate plug, at the bottom, and three plugs are placed, minimum three plugs. So those are called abandonment plugs. So these are purposes of placing plugs. So how a plug job, see this, this is explained. This plug job, this is a thin zone, this is a weak zone, or cement, it is, you are not able to control. So now cement plug is placed here, and then we pull out, wash it, and the cement will set, and it will, some cement will go into the thin zone at least. But it is actually in pay zone, we avoid placing the cement plug, because cement plug, once actually cement goes into this thing, it actually blocks the pores of the formation and the permeability is affected. So then you need to carry out the acid jobs and all to activate the well. So it, we avoid placing the cement. It's a last resort. We are required to place this. It's stopping loss circulation, as I have explained. Direction well, you see. See here, fish is there. Now we need to place the plug and then you do sidetracking. The sidetracking is done. Okay. Or sometime along with the whipstock, in the casing also you need to side, so below whipstock also sometime to support, though it whipstock this thing, biting seams, so, and the packer also, but for additional this thing safety, sometimes we place the plug below the whipstock also. So this is actually zonal isolation. So what happens, say suppose in the bottom zone, I have taken production, and now I have to come up to another zone on the top. So what we do, actually carry out the, place the plug here, isolate this zone, because it is perforated, carry out the squeeze and place the plug above this, so that there is no migration of fluid into the wellbore. And now we go higher and zone transfer. Well, now we actually perforate another zone and take production from there. Zonal isolation is done. This is abandonment. See, three plugs, one, two, three plugs are placed for abandonment. See how we actually place the plug. With the open end drill pipe is a pipe for the tubing, we actually should avoid tubing because the strength of the tubing is very less. But sometimes we are actually forced to run the tubing, because suppose you don't have the drill pipe stands, then you use the tubing. At shallower depths, but in deep wells, we should avoid using tubing for placing the plugs, because deep well, suppose any stuck up or any cement starts holding the casing, you may not apply excess pull. So tensile strength of the tubing is various. So drill pipe has to be used. So this plug, suppose place the plug here of requisite height. This height, the pink you see, hash lines. This is cement slurry. So balance plug method. Why it is called balance? See, this is my dotted line is mud. Suppose at this depth, I need to place the plug. So, and then what I do, because to separate the cement slurry with the mud, I pump a requisite quantity of pre-flush. It is pre-flush. It is water, W, water. Okay. If water or spacer, if the well water cannot be pumped, if the well conditions do not allow water to be pumped, then properly designed spacer has to be pumped instead of water. So I presume the well conditions permit, so I pump water here. So water is pumped ahead of the cement slurry such that the height of the water in the endless is same as that of in the tubing, once, so that the displacement is complete. This is completely balanced. Hydrostatically, it is balanced. Otherwise, what will happen? Otherwise, suppose it is under balance, then flow will take place from here inside to outside. Okay. Or if it is over balance, then it will go. The plug will get disturbed, it will get contaminated. So the calculated displacement is done. Calculated volume of water behind and after the cement slurry is pumped and displaced in such a manner that it forms a balanced plug. So if the capacity of the hole between the hole and the tubing or the drill pipe which I am using is three times the capacity of the drill pipe here, so the volume of pre-flush is to be used three times the volume, the this thing, and the height of the peak should be 150 to 200 feet. Okay, that much of column is there. Then again, we have to see the hole condition, where are, if any zone is there, anything. So the calculated volume has to be pumped. So better it is to have 150 to 200 feet of water column, long water column, and the plug. Plug is actually 50 to 100 meter plug, 150 meter. That also depends on, suppose you want to sidetrack and the formation strength is much more, compressive strength is very high, it's very hard, formation is very hard. So you need to place a longer, this thing, longer plug, or it is a very highly deviated hole. Then that case also, suppose you place a plug of 75 meter or 100 meter, then it will get contaminated. Part of it will get contaminated and you will drill through the plug and you'll be wasting the time. Then you'll be required to place another plug. So you place a plug of longer column so that contamination is also taken care of. So depending upon the well condition, that cementing engineer decides how long the plug should be, volume and the plug should be placed. Now, after placing and displacing is over, you pull out the drill pipe slowly 50 to 100 meter above the top of the plug. Now see, when the pipe is pulled out, this water, this will become one, and this is cement slurry, and below is the mud column, which was actually there. It is, we are not concerned about, because we were to place the cement plug here at this depth. Okay, so this cement plug is there. Now already pulled out of this. Now if any leftover cement is there, what we'll do, we'll close the BOP and circulate it out, reverse circulation. It's called reverse circulation. Okay, so at least 1.5 times steam volume is pumped through this thing and reverse circulation is done. But see, the cementing engineer decides. Again, sometimes actually we do direct circulation. In which conditions we do direct circulation? Because when we do reverse circulation, the bottom hole condition, because the frictional losses inside ID of this string is less, so the frictional pressure inside the string are more, so the reverse circulation pressures are more. So suppose there is a thief zone and I am placing a plug and I am doing reverse circulation at a reasonable pumping rate, what will happen? The bottom hole pressure will be more. Bottom hole pressure will be more. So the loss, this cement, I may lose the cement slurry. So based upon the condition, well condition and the depth, or if suppose the angle is very, very high, very, very high. So in that case, the steam will not be at the center. It will be at the side. So the cement may remain in the side. You need to intermittently rotate or reciprocate while doing it. But you cannot do it in intermittent rotation or reciprocation in case of reverse wash, because BOP is closed. You cannot rotate the steam. For reverse wash, you need to close the BOP. Unless it has to be closed. This unless has to be closed. So in that condition, bottom hole, suppose pressure rate restriction is there or angle is very, very high. In that case, we actually carry out the direct circulation. Only disadvantage in having the direct circulation is because this contamination, it contaminates the mud. So you may have to throw out the mud, slightly more larger volume of mud. Okay, but that disadvantage is there. And the cement, which will actually passes through BOP and the riser. BOP and the riser. So actually some people have reservation, drilling people have reservation, I should not have the cement against this thing. But if you have proper cleaning, if you have at a faster rate cleaning and fast rotation, in direct circulation, you can rotate the steam fast. Then I have done maybe hundreds of jobs in my this thing career. So there is no problem. So this is how balanced cement is done. balance plug. I have already explained this. Now, reason of failure. Why actually cement plus phase? Mud contamination, I have already told, improper displacement. Either you excessively displace or you under displace too much of this thing, then only water is, cement plug will get contaminated, or possible downward movement. How, why downward movement will take place? If the hole size is very, very big and the mud weight is very low, so in that case, downward movement can take place. Otherwise, generally, if the mud weight and the cement weight is not much difference, and there is no thin zone below this, and the non-loss is taking place, so generally, sliding down of plug does not take place. So in such cases, we actually sometimes place high viscous fill, very high viscous fill of 200 second viscosity, 150, 200 second viscosity, so that the plug does not slide and below the plug depth. Now it is squeeze cementation. Squeeze cementation is classified as a low pressure squeeze and high pressure squeeze. Now packer squeeze, sometimes we use packer also, it's called retainer, through which we actually, there are two types of tools, but one tool has become obsolete. It is cementer. Cementer is also used sometimes, but it is obsolete, it's rarely used. Now, generally, retainer is used. So, retainer we can use. And why retainer is used? Suppose you are doing casing repair job, whereas you have the casing is damaged at 2-3 points. And when you apply the pressure, the mud will enter, the pressure will actually not transmit to the depth where we want to carry out the squeeze. And suppose the casing damage is at the surface also, there is a limitation casing. You cannot go up to the squeeze pressure, then use the retainer. So in the endless, the column above the retainer will be isolated. So only below retainer, casing is pressurized. And casing is pressurized from outside the endless. So we have to check for the collapse pressure is designed. When I'll be telling you in detail, then I'm covering only basics here. So this is actually, again, Braden and this same open end plug method is Braden and it's also called Braden end. Now this is, a packer or retainer, okay. This is actually now, this sometimes it comes with a stabbing tool and the seal also, or this retainer has a seal and this is also stabbing tool, also a seal. It goes and sits here and then you circulate here. And you can place, you can squeeze. Here, suppose casing is damaged here. Suppose from here, this at this apparatus. Now it is isolated. When you apply pressure, only pressure is acting in the drill string or the tubing string. It is acting inside. So it is not acting in the here in the endless. So this portion, suppose casing is also weak here. So it is isolated. Now, when you carry out the squeeze here, the pressure applies here. Squeeze pressure. Okay. Squeeze pressure. So this pressure now may act because suppose there is a communication behind the casing. So for the maximum pressure, now we have to check for the collapse here. When you apply the pressure, squeeze pressure here, and if the casing is weak, so we should not exceed the collapse pressure. And generally the collapse pressure of casing is less than the bus casing pressure. Okay, especially for larger dia casings. The difference is more. For smaller dia casings, it is less. Difference is less. Difference between the bus pressure and the collapse pressure is less. So this is how, again, then when it is stabbed out, this also has NRV. When you pull out the steam stabbing tool, then it comes up and you can reverse wash or the direct wash as the case may be. Okay, you can do it and now there is no cement. And now this is squeeze. Squeeze is done. Now you can drill through. Or suppose this is not required, you can come up. This is also worked as an isolation plug. Above this, you can additional safety place a bridge, another bridge plug above it, and then you can test to positive and negative test, and you can do zone transfer. Suppose you want to produce from above, you can do it. High pressure squeezing. There is one is actually high pressure squeezing and low pressure. High pressure squeezing is the one where the injection pressure. When you apply the pressure from the top, from the surface, onto the cement slurry, that pressure is called squeeze pressure. And if that squeeze pressure is more than the formation fracture pressure, it is called high pressure squeeze. Okay. And when it is less, mostly suppose it is thief zone and this, when it's so slow pressure, and sometimes it is so less, low pressure squeeze also, we carry out the squeeze cementation in hesitation. We pump small volume, then stop for a while. We allow the nodes to be built up. Then it is called hesitation method, slowly, slowly. Okay. These applications I have already told. You can go through it hurriedly. So sometimes actually what happens, this is actually water, this is actually shown in the figure. It is shown the water should be below oil. It is wrongly shown water. Okay, water being heavier, normally water, unless it is a separate zone, different layer. But in a single same zone, gas is on top, oil is in between, bottommost is water. In the figure I have copied, it is wrongly showed. Okay, but there may be some barrier or maybe some other water zone. It is showing that this, suppose when you take the the production for a long period of time, the coning occurs, water coning or the gas coning also occurs. The quantity GOR increases or the oil water ratio also increases. So it is not economical to produce. Then we have to go for repair squeeze job. That is called water shutoff jobs if excessive water is flown. So water has actually now, it's difficult to handle the water at the surface. You are unnecessarily wasting the energy. And water being heavier than the oil, sometimes it actually kills also. Well, it's killed. So it is difficult to stimulate. Then you have to carry out number of stimulation jobs to again stimulate the job. So now this is actually another, you see this water coning has taken place. This is the bottom and excessive. This actually pays in. It was earlier this thick. So over the years, it has become thin. And now, see, gas is entering from here and the water is entering from here. So now, for either for control gas or to oil, we need to carry out the squeeze jobs and then re-perforate and take the well on production again after stimulation. So this is actually, see, this is suppose this is a repair job. Suppose there is channel behind this. This is a cement sheet endless. So there is actually channel behind this. Already there is a channel. So this needs to be repaired. So perforation is done against it and it is squeezed cement slurry. That is repair job, or if, because of corrosion also. Suppose casing is damaged because of corrosion, then also we can carry out the cement squeeze job to repair this. And if not the case in larger casing, sometimes we prefer using this because these cement jobs are actually temporary squeeze jobs. Nowadays, we have different chemicals. Some chemicals are also available. We can actually pump, which work as cementitious material. So those materials can also be pumped to this because cement actually, when it's subjected to over time to acid jobs and all, it actually gets dissolved. So then also, then again, it is not reliable. So we may have to carry out squeeze jobs repeatedly. So by doing use it, we may know. But we have to record use it in corrosion mode. Then we know where the casing damage is, and by locating the point, we actually carry out the job. Otherwise, it's very difficult. Otherwise, we have to run the RTTS tool, set it, and then check which portion, then identify and sinks at the spot where the casing leak is there. Now, summary, cement job is very important at the first shot that I have mentioned in the red, that it should be first job so that to avoid squeeze jobs, because especially in offshore, it's very, very expensive. And it is actually, we are compromising on well integrity because repair jobs are not only time consuming, actually it affects the well integrity also. So in the first stage, we should plan properly and execution. Planning, designing, planning and execution has to be done meticulously for good cementation, good primary cementation job. Now, briefly, I'll tell you about the equipment for cementing operation. This is actually how bulk, this is a very conventional, very old method, conventional method. Bulk dry cement is coming. It's a hopper. And this is a mixing jet, high pressure mixing jet, combination of, I think this is a Schlumberger design, multiple jets. So it is a Schlumberger unit has this, and this is a bypass valve. So if you want to add on extra water, this bypass valve, through bypass valve, jet valves are there, ball valves. It's controlled at the unit console where operator can control this. And this jet mix, because of Bernoulli's principle, this jet, when a high velocity jet is there and with the gravity, it comes down and this butterfly wall is open, or sometimes sluice wall is also used. You can partially open it and control the sea, and the cement slurry is formed. It comes, falls into one tub and goes into another. And then see, why I was telling this BC is important. From this tub, unless this tub is placed above this thing in PSM unit, in PSM or in RCM units, you get the mixing tub is above the suction point of the reciprocating pump. Because for pumping, you need to use reciprocating pump. You can use centrifugal pumps, but centrifugal pump will also be required to suck the slurry from the tub. So for sucking, that is why I was telling you 30 BC is the maximum BC for sucking the slurry. Okay. And for displacement, 100 BC is the maximum, or 70 BC. Some companies follow this 70 BC rule, and some companies actually 70. These are the bulk silos. Actually, very pneumatic pneumatic transfer take place. So these silos actually are filled with the cement of having a capacity of maybe 50 ton, 100 ton, 200 ton. These are vertical silos. These are stationary silos. And these have actually connections, transfer lines. You see why walls are butterfly walls are there, number of. One is transfer line and one is intake line and one is vent line. So the silo from where the transfer is taking place, vent line is closed. The silo is pressurized to 30 to 40 PSI, depending upon the distance from silo to this. And offshore also the same silos are from the bulk handling plant. This blending is also done, dry blending. When dry blending is done, so the loading pod chemicals are added and this blending is done. This is actually mobile silos. These are mobile bulk handling unit. It is also called bulk cement handling units. This actually compressor is there, and this is surge tank hopper. It is actually aligned on above the hopper, mixing hopper, which I showed you in the previous slide. And the cement falls here, and under pressure, this cement comes from the silo, this container, and this silo cement comes and falls into the surge tank, and surge tank to the hopper, and then it is actually mechanically it is not possible to put one by one this thing. Earlier, bunkers was used, which had screw conveyors, and mechanically when it used to rotate and mechanically it used to fall. Whereas this is very, very conventional. Blending is also very easy. You can reshuffle the silos very fast. Now those bunkers have become obsolete worldwide. Even in ONGC and Oil India, we have stopped using this thing. So now pneumatic transfer takes place. So this pneumatic transfer can take place at the rate of 1 to 2 metric ton of the conventional cement per minute. Okay. So this is conventional. This is actually RCM unit. This RCM is recirculating unit. It's made of Halliburton. Halliburton RCM, recirculating mixture. Okay. BJ Baker has PSM system. Okay. And similarly, this Schlumberger also has. See, this is a hopper, and these reciprocating pumps are here, these reciprocating pumps. And these are hoses, this is a console, these are displacement tank where the mixed water is taken. Mixed water is taken here, it has set of walls, and this is mixing manifold. And we have this thing, and this is a console where the operator can see the pressure at which he is pumping the cement slurry or the fluids into the wellbore. And these are accessories. This is a deck engine. This is chassis engine. This is PTO. This is PTO, and this is a cabin, driver's cabin, and it is a mobile cementing unit. And this is a conventional set of this centrifugal pumps for boosting. This is a centrifugal pump for mixed water tank. These are the reciprocating pumps. You see in orange color. Using this, these are normally triplex pumps. And the plunger, it has a plunger, and in mud pumps, you have a piston and liner system, whereas in cement pumps, these are high pressure precision pump, positive displacement pumps, reciprocating pumps. So these are actually high. So normally, worldwide, the displacement is of the order of 6 to 8 inch, and the dia is actually plunger. Sometimes you can change it, maybe 3.5 to 6 inch, 6.5 inch plungers are available. So depending upon the pressure requirements, you select the size of plunger. If you are carrying out operations in shallow depths and you require higher discharge, so you use larger dia plungers, okay? To increase the discharge, but the pressure requirement is less. And whereas the pressure requirement, you deep wells or high pressure squeeze jobs, or you are carrying out fractures, hydrofracture jobs, or very high pressure jobs, some packer settings and all that, so that you need a smaller plunger size. So now it's over. Now I'll be covering another this thing detail tomorrow and day after tomorrow. Now we have 10 minutes. Any questions, please? Have you please understood? Because I'm taking first time this with the slideshow, and I'm not used to teaching class. I enjoy having eye contact. I can speak slowly.
No, sir, you are explained very excellently.
Thank you.
And your slides are also very good.
Thank you for your compliments. Please, have any questions? Please, participants, don't hesitate. You ask any type of question, any question.
Hello, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, can you please explain how well cementing is a closed system? I didn't get it.
How process?
Well, cementing is a closed system.
Closed system? See,
yes.
I told you in the beginning, see in the slide, I'll go back to the slide. Closed system is what? The outside endless is open because return is coming, return of fluid is coming. So it is a closed system. See these slides? This is cementing head. Outside it is closed. You are pumping slurry, but inside it is a closed system. It has to be closed system. Suppose it is not a closed system. I pump the cement. And I am opening the cap of the cementing head to load the plug. What will happen? Because there is a long column of cement inside, which is much heavier than the mud. Because of you tubing, it will turn down. As you open the, see, has anyone? Because all your students have not seen the operations. So in the endless, it is a light fluid is there. You understand? It is light fluid. In the first slide, it is same density of the fluid is same, but here you see in the second slide, cement slurry has been pumped. It is occupying this height, and the density of the slurry is more. So the density of the column inside is more than outside. This column, this extra, this much. Okay, HOG. Hello.
Yes.
Listening.
Okay. Yes, sir.
So because of the density, high density. If you open the cap, what will happen? Because of you tubing, it will suck the air. So you should not open the cap. So you should from inside, it should remain the cap. What will happen? It will go down. Even if I have stopped pumping, say I have pumped this much volume, I have not dropped the plug. So presume this plug is already on top. I have pumped the cement volume. Okay, cement slurry will be up to here. So what will happen? This, because of you tubing, this slurry will run down. Okay, it will continue. What will happen? Interface, because I have not started pumping anything. I have only finished pumping cement. So the cement column will stick. Why? Because it is very long. See what happens when you have a pitot. You have seen the pitot in the laboratory.
Yes, sir.
When it is filled with water, you shut it from the top. You shut it from the top, it does not fall. Why does it not fall? Because it is only atmospheric pressure is acting on it. But whereas in this case, suppose you have a 500 meter of column, you know, even if your valve is closed, it will run down. What happens actually when it goes down, the interface between the air, this interface, the fluid which is on the top, because of lower this thing pressure, vacuum is created on top, and because of lower vapor pressure, part of the liquid which gets vaporizes and it is void. When the displacement starts and the U2B exits completely, when you will witness this actually, you will see the chattering, chattering noise. That is because of the evaporation of this. When you are displacing it, when unless U2B is complete, you hear chattering noise. That is because of chatter, like that, because evaporation is taking place. But if you accidentally, if you open the cap, or if any system is open, what will happen? Because of UTV, because it is already running down from the top, will it not suck the air? It will.
Yes, sir.
It will suck the air. So where will that air go? Once the displacement will complete, it will slowly it will pass through the cement slurry. And by the time cement actually is set, thickening time is achieved, that will get there itself, it will get trapped. So there will be voids, the whole cement job will be spoiled. Will it not? If you have air inside this, air trapped inside the cement slurry.
Yes, sir.
So that is why we use cement container. Cement, this thing we call cementing head. After all types of casing, even for liner jobs, because liner is run on the drill pipe. It is not run on the casing because casing is not coming up to the surface. Or similarly, in deep water also, wellhead is a seabed. I can teach you that detail because I don't want to go into that detail. But the wellhead is at the seabed. Casings are hanging there. So casing is run onto the drill pipe again. So there we actually circulating head is different. The plugs are fitted. I have not gone into the subsea cementation. In subsea cementation, plugs are fitted in the casing itself. And there is a system where you drop the ball. A PVC ball is dropped and that goes inside and that rests on the bottom plug, and when you apply the pressure, then it a coupling is there that breaks and then bottom plug goes down. But it has to be done in a closed manner. Inside it should has to be clear. Outside is open. You see outlet, I have seen the arrow, it is mud is coming out. It has to be open. Here what pressure is acting here? What pressure is acting? It is only atmospheric pressure. Whereas what pressure is acting here? Hydrostatic head inside, outside, because it is same. It is because fluid is homogeneous, inside, outside, same fluid. But what pressure is acting here? Hydrostatic head of this column, this cement slurry, plus this. Because this hydrostatic head is less. So what is actually causing? It is causing the velocity. It will start pumping this slurry automatically because of gravity. Pressure differential is created because of density. You got it?
Yes, sir.
Because of UTV. UTV, you know very well, if heavy fluid is there inside fluid will move out. That is why I explained in the beginning, you have not understood. Because once it is displacement is complete, same thing will happen from endless to inside. That is why these float shoe and float collar have NRVs. These are called NRV, non-returning walls, because we cannot allow the cement slurry to come inside once it is placed in the endless. But I told you another thing, that once the displacement is complete, we can close the wall inside, this wall. Then also it will not come. But what will happen, I explained you that time, that if you close the wall inside, the cement slurry only a small quantity, because the mud inside is not compressible, partially incompressible, because it may have some trapped air. It will get slightly compressed. Only small quantity of cement will enter it. But what is the disadvantage? When the cement will set, the casing will expand because of thermal expansion. So this inside wall, when the displacement is complete, now here, after displacement is complete at this stage, I need to open this. Why? Because thermal expansion will take, I'll have to allow the mud, because this has NRVs here and here, and plugs are on top of it. Suppose I will check the NRV first. I will open the wall here and check if at any flow is taking place in this. Suppose this is failed, both these walls are failed, then what will happen? Because this endless is heavier, the mud will start flowing out. It will slow. What will I do? In that case, I will apply the differential pressure, because there is a differential pressure. Okay, whatever last pumping pressure, differential pressure was there, I will apply the differential pressure, maybe 50 psi extra for safety, and keep it under pressure unless this. But this is not a good condition. because this pressure along with some more pressure will be built up because of thermal expansion. Because bottom hole here, the temperature is more, whereas this slurry and mud that I have pumped, that is at the ambient temperature. But this slurry, which is at the bottom, maybe at 70 degree centigrade, 80 degree centigrade. So everything will expand now. So that will lead to expansion of casing also. Partial expansion, even if it actually expands in microns, micro annulus will be created. Micro annulus are nothing, but it is in microns, very small, through which gas can pass, but water or oil cannot pass. You understood? Any other question, please?
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
It is clear now?
Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, please. Any other question?
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, you said there are some disadvantages in two-stage cementing.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Can you repeat it once?
Okay. See, I'll come back here again. I'll come to slide. Because why did I carry out the two-stage cementation? Because the well conditions do not permit me. Either well formation pressure, well fracture pressure, formation pressure is less than the hydrostatic head of the displaced slurry. Getting me? Or the ECD?
Yes, sir.
If the ECD, even after displacement, hydrostatic, once I stop pumping, the hydrostatic itself is much higher, I will lose the slurry into the formation. What is the point in placing the slurry if I lose the slurry? Okay. And the level in the LS will go down. So I do not want that condition. So first of all, under compulsion, because I cannot raise the, and if I raise the column very long, suppose there are two zones are maybe 1500 meter apart. So will I have a single hole, volume will be very large, management will be difficult. And because when you have a very large column, the temperature difference between the top of the slurry and the bottom of the slurry is also different. The slurry which is at the higher temperature will set first, okay? And which is at the lower temperature, it will not set. And the topmost slurry will get contaminated because it is traveling through in the LS for a long, long. Inside, I'll take care by using the plugs, rubber plugs, and separating the slurry. But in the LS, only spacer I'm pumping. More it will come in contact with the formation for longer period, long more in contact. So more it will get contaminated, will it not?
That is
why I'm doing two-stage cementation, correct? But in two-stage cementation, when I'm doing second-stage cementation, when I will attempt the second-stage cementation, I told you that I open the port by putting this plug I pump lower, or by it is hydraulically operated, then I apply the pressure after bumping, the first stage is over. Only after that I carry out the second-stage cementation. After thickening time of first stage is over, then only I carry out. Got it?
If
the thickening time is there, slurry is in liquid stage, I carry out the second stage job, then again, it will be subjected to more pressure. So I will carry out once at least thickening time of this first stage is over, then I'll open the port. I'll open the port and I will circulate. So now once the port is opened, the bottom portion of the casing is the same, huh? Casing is the same. I cannot reciprocate or rotate the casing. Can I?
No.
Because first stage cementation has been done. I explained nicely. I explained very slowly this thing. Because first stage cementation has been done, you do not want it to be disturbed. If you pull the casing, that the cementation will be disturbed. You will have very poor cementation first stage. So now you have to rest the casing there itself, where it was, okay, without disturbing the first stage cementation. You cannot reciprocate. That is the limitation, isn't it? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You got it?
Yes, sir.
And another disadvantage which I did not cover, see, it is related to drilling. See, now actually drill out diameter, when you drill it, part of the actually inner sleeves are also inner sleeve in the middle, this closing sleeve, that is also part of inner sleeve will be drilled completely. Okay, this plug will also be drilled, this portion will be drilled. So sometimes what happens actually when it is subjected to high pressure, there is a stop ring that I have not explained because it is a preliminary lecture. For the closing, this is a closing. See, this is a closing sleeve. This closes the port. Okay, this sleeve you are seeing. This is opening sleeve orange one. The second orange one goes down, slides. It is a little latch on. This plug will latch on, and this closing sleeve, yellow one, will slide down. It will close the ports. These ports have to be closed. Some, and it has a, this has a stop ring, a stop collar here at the bottom. So if it actually breaks, this stop, this collar, stop collar breaks, then I have seen, you have experience. Normally, it should not, design of the stage collar should be shut. It should not break. But sometimes, if suppose excessive pressure applied, or this is that this breaks, then actually your ports are exposed. And because these are quite large size ports, and squeezing these ports, repairing these ports is very, very difficult. Sometimes we may have to carry out 3-4 squeeze jobs. Now you can understand how many rig days are lost. You have to carry out the job, drill it, and then again test it, then again carry out the job if you carry out 3 or 4. That is, these are the some of the disadvantages. So two-stage cementation job is, you can say, as a necessary evil. We avoid it using, like, okay, so it is a necessary evil. Next, any other question? Please. Any other question? Participants, please do ask questions, no problem. The questions are welcome.
Hello, sir. Hello.
Question, no other question?
Hello.
Hello, yes.
Hello, sir. Does primary cementing seal off lost circulation zone, or is it only the plug cementing?
Our intention is not any cement should enter if it is a producing zone. Okay. Suppose nearby there's a producing zone. Okay. We will close nearby producing zone is there. We don't want any cement to be. I told in the beginning that it's a last resort to place the cement. Okay. Suppose nearby there is a thief zone, lost zone is there, or the producing zone is at the bottom. Because what will happen, suppose lost zone is very close, the cement also enters into this information, and that damages it. The stimulation you need to carry out, even after acid jobs, the original permeability can never be restored. So this actually blocks the permeability. That is why it is there. So we avoid using this, actually. Avoid using. But still, as I told you, this is a last resort. Suppose by a conventional methods, other methods, by using different loss circulating pills in the mud system and other things, diacylam and all that, which is you are not able to control the loss, then the last resort, we use lightweight gel cement slurries for placing of adequate, and then that loss may, still loss may occur, take place. Or sometimes suppose you are placing the above the loss zone, and cement is placed because just mud below slides down and it is healed, then cement will set, will drill through. But normally it doesn't happen. Some cement will go into the loss zone. That is why we were forced to use the cementation for checking the loss. Had it been controlled by convention, this thing would have been, so some cement will go, that only some cement will definitely go against the loss circulation zone. Yes. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
Anything else? Please ask about anything, more questions. I'm open.
Hello, sir.
Sir,
this float collar and this gate shoe, we will install it from the surface, or we will do in the subsurface?
Subsurface means what? I don't understand. You know, all casing jobs, plug is left. Say, very large casing, even in conductor casings, we are not using conventional rubber plugs. We are not using large casing, 30-inch, 20-inch, okay? So they are actually, contamination does not matter much inside, because very large casing, we do not have the cementing heads, 20-inch casing, 30-inch casing, cementing heads not available. Only swell circulating heads are available. So there is no point in actually using the float collar and all that, okay? Suppose when the head is not used, so we do not use the conventional plug, rubber plug. So there also, we actually under-displace. We displace calculated volume of slurry because plug will not hit. We leave a 20 to 25 meter plug inside the shoe there also. Hello, my answer is clear.
Yes, thank you, sir.
But no, all other casing we use, all casing jaws, whether it is on deep water, in the water, we use actually for shoe track is used.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yes, any other question? Anybody? It's okay, I just did not notice the time. I did not do. We also it's about 9:30, nearly 2 hours have elapsed now. So we shall join tomorrow again.
Yes, sir.
How was the only 20 have left? I think people got bored. They most of them have more than 50% left. Hello, Jan.
No,
you are still there?
Sir is very interesting and your presentation is also very good and we are blessed of our knowledge.
Yes, I expect questions from you. If you see, I can even tell you in advance, but many advanced things I can tell, but that will not be perhaps understood by most participants. So it is better to tell you preliminary things which actually is sufficient, will suffice you for the interview and all the
yes, sir.
For your exams and all that. Okay. And I presume most of you are petroleum engineers. So
yes,
you may understand this actually. Perhaps
yes,
in the college, in the books, it is not.
Yes, you're right, sir.
I think. So because I'm a practical man, basically I'm not a petroleum engineer, I'm a mechanical engineer. But I have a long experience in UGC. So I would rather welcome questions from you, some practical questions, so that I can clarify your doubts.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Anyway, tomorrow we'll actually again join. Thank you very much. Good night.
Okay. Same to you, sir.
Thank you.